As a folklorist who has spent the last 30 years studying the cultural traditions of my home state, I'm dedicated to documenting and presenting the cultural roots of Alabama. Ride along as I encounter Alabama's folk practices where they occur and meet the people who continue them. I'm Joey Brackner, and this is Journey Proud. This time on Journey Proud, we're going to the Montgomery Motor Speedway to learn about short track racing. We'll meet drivers, crews, and fans and experience the exciting sport of racing up close. Alabama enjoys a prominent place in American racing culture. It was here at Montgomery Motor Speedway and tracks like it that racing greats like the Allison Brothers and Neil Bonnett made their names. This type of track represents the grassroots of where auto racing stars are born. Track manager Paul Boswell has invited us to come out and learn firsthand about late model short track racing. This is a subject I know relatively little about. I'm excited to be able to have a pit crew's view on the inner workings of this complex sport. Today is the day before the race when drivers and crews are frantically adjusting their cars, looking for a competitive edge for tomorrow's race. We're hoping a team will allow us to hang out with them and experience the excitement and challenge of serious racing. I expect to learn a lot about racing this weekend, starting with the importance of tuning the car and practicing.
This is one of the big early events of the season, and we've seen a couple of wrecks, but things seem to be under control, no bad wrecks, and some really fast and loud cars. I'm debating on whether or not I need earplugs. I did not grow up a fan of car racing, but just in watching these practice runs, I've learned a lot in talking to drivers and crew members. These are people that, unlike me, have been really into the sport all their lives. And I'm learning a lot, and it is hard not to get kind of swept up into the excitement of someone running into the wall, some malfunction with the car, watching the crews fine-tune. Trying to talk while a loud race car is going around you, but the infield is the place to be.
It is really hard to describe how incredibly loud it is in the infield, these powerful cars zooming around. At times, having a simple conversation is nearly impossible. I consider myself very Southern and of Alabama, so I've always felt a little guilty about not following racing, especially as many of my friends and family really love it. It is such a Southern sport, and in particular one in which Alabamians have excelled. We naturally gravitated to the Hunter Robbins team. It turns out that he is a local talent and seems to have a promising racing career ahead of him. Hunter Robbins is a young engineering student from Auburn University who somehow finds the time to live his dream of being a race car driver. His mentor, Ronnie Sanders, who spent many years on the NASCAR circuit, has taken him under his wing. A valued member of Hunter's pit crew, Stevieray, invited us to visit Hunter's garage for some background on racing and Hunter's career.
So this is Hunter Robbins' garage.
That's correct.
And I can see all of these great trophies. And Hunter is how old now?
21. 21
that's
years old.
That's awfully young.
Yep.
And I can see, just looking in this garage, for someone so young, how successful he's been with all these trophies.
He's been very successful, but it's a lot of work. I mean, he's you know, spent a lot of time at it.
You know, being in a space like this, it's obvious that racing is a team sport, and he's part of that team other than just a driver, right?
Oh, yes. He's the main person that basically assembles the car. I mean, he does all the prep work. You know, the other crew members, we all have 40-hour week jobs. You know, we can't, you know, concentrate on that mm-hmm. exclusively. This is not what we do for a living. Mm-hmm. You know, and Hunter goes to school and works on the race car. And it's, you know, it's his machine that he brings to the track. So,
and you know, right now Hunter's successful, and he primarily is racing short track.
That's correct. Yep. Throughout the southeast,
and that's pretty much a network of smaller racetracks, right?
Half mile asphalt speedways. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And so, you know, it not being an expert on sure. racing. My impression is that the short track scene is kind of where this whole racing culture began in America.
That's correct.
You want to talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Well, I mean, in reality, moonshine back when there was prohibition mm-hmm. is what sort of got the whole ball rolling with racing cars, mm-hmm. you know, in the country, you know, not IndyCar professional. And what right. you had was, you had moonshiners all through the, you know, through the nation would load moonshine in their cars. Well, when they go down the road, they load those, you know, these old Chevrolets, you know, 34 Fords or whatever, and the cars would, the tail ends would be low to the ground. And so the local law enforcement knew he was hauling moonshine, and they'd go chase him down. They knew, you know, he was guilty by design because the mm-hmm. car was going down, you know, at an angle. So they started modifying the suspension so that when they loaded the car full of, mm-hmm. you know, it would actually sit straight up, right. and they loaded it full of moonshine, it would level out. Mm-hmm. And so that eliminated the, you know, the that giving them away. And then when they would get in a chase with law enforcement, or they'd have to outrun them, they would work on the motors to outrun the police. Because back in those days, there might be one county sheriff, and if you outran him, you got away. I mean, mm-hmm. that's just... So they worked on motors, they work on the suspension. Well, what they would do is they'd go to church on Sunday morning. And in the afternoon, they had all these hot cars with the motors souped up and the suspensions, you know, tuned to do what they want to do. So they would go out in a pasture and, like, you know, put two 55-gallon drums at two ends, and they started racing each other around. Mm. You know, and each one they'd brag about whose car was the best, or you know, who could do the best, or who could outdrive the best. They said, hey, let's put up some bleachers and charge money to come see this. Mm-hmm. And that it evolved from there, you know.
This is really where it begins. You assemble a car in a garage like this.
Right.
And then you're a racer. But then if you're successful, what mm-hmm. happens?
Well, as in Hunter's case, you move on, there'll be a car owner who's, you know, better funded and, you know, can have multiple cars instead of just one. Mm-hmm. And they hire you to drive their equipment, you know. And that's the next progression. You move up that level and just...
Well, who is Hunter driving for?
Ronnie Sanders.
Ronnie, okay.
Yeah. He's a Hall of Fame driver out of Georgia.
Out of Georgia, right.
And that's where the car that we used to keep here is now in his shop, you know. You put together a fleet, basically, mm-hmm. of cars when you get to that level to race every weekend, you know.
Well, what strikes me is the complexity of the sport, because you have athletic skill in driving a car, but you also have this mechanical
correct
know-how to keep a, you know, a car within the rules of whatever, you know,
right.
the rules committee gives you
right
to make it competitive. And you know, in this garage, just looking around, and I used to be an archaeologist, I can see all of the evidence, the stratigraphy
sure.
of Hunter Robbins' career, from a go-kart to little bitty trophies to really big, much, much bigger trophies around in this garage. And it looks like y'all are going to have to expand the garage just for the trophies if Hunter keeps racing.
I think he won his first track championship when he was like 6 and a half years old, his mother told me. So in a and she wanted to make sure I said that it was between 8 and 10 years old. He was 6 and a half and he was racing against 8 and 10 year olds.
And he couldn't even get in that little vehicle now. Well, now tell us a little bit about the team. There's a team that has to come together.
Right.
To make the racer successful. Who are these people and what are the kind of things that they do?
Well, we have, like I said, it starts with the owner, Ronnie Sanders. He's you know, the main guy, you know, car owner. Mm-hmm. And we have Hunter, the driver. Then we have a crew chief, a gentleman named David Ray, who lives in Huntsville. And he's very good at what he does. And, you know, as far as the strategy and calling the shots and what shocks and springs that we need to do. And Hunter and the crew chief really communicate together, you know, as far as fine-tuning the machine at the track to get it, you know, as fast as it possibly can.
Well, Mr. Sanders, the veteran.
Right.
With all of his life of experience, does he get in there?
Oh,
and get
yes.
His hands
oh,
greasy?
Yes. Oh, yes. He's a hands-on car owner. He's not a, you know, sit on top of the trailer car owner. He's, as a matter of fact, you know, the cars are at his shop. He works on those cars
right.
along with Hunter. You know, Hunter now commutes to Atlanta to work on the cars, mm-hmm. you know, so from Auburn to Atlanta and back.
It almost sounds like there's a master apprenticeship system here with, I can imagine a retired veteran racer like
right.
Mr. Sanders and Hunter coming up.
Pretty much.
And they're working under the hood together.
Pretty much.
And a lot of teaching goes on there, correct?
Yeah. That's it's a wealth of knowledge. I mean, there's not a racing college. You know, you learn all this, you know, hands-on, you know. Mm-hmm. That's the only way to do it. So, yeah, there is a progression, you know, of knowledge that gets passed down.
You know, I get the impression there are a lot of young people that are involved in, I mean, what I consider very young people.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, like, even younger than college-age people.
Oh, yeah. We race against, there's Jeff Burton's little son. Like I said, you know, we race against a lot of the kids of the NASCAR, you know, elite. There's a little Burton kid that we've raced. He's 12 years old, you know. He's about this high. Mm-hmm. You know, his seat looks like a seat you'd put in a, you know, the back of seat of a car, you know. Mm-hmm. He's he's good. He's very good. But at 12 years old, he's like Hunter. He's been racing his whole life. That's all he's ever known. That's all he's ever done. So.
Well, you know, and it's easy to understand how if your dad is a famous racer, you might be a racer. But then, you know, there are others that just come out of nowhere, but they know they want to be, they want to race cars.
Right.
And, you know, that's amazing. And it's happening at a very young age. And now I understand there are a lot of women drivers, or at least some women drivers.
Sure.
And certainly a lot of interest among women in racing.
Yeah. There's a lot of women that are up and coming that are at the same level that Hunter is, you know, across the country, you know, in Indiana and Ohio. There's a few women in every series in every region, basically.
Stevie Ray, would you show me around the garage?
Sure, we'll wander around and see what we can find.
All right.
Stevie Ray gave us a tour of the rest of the shop and explained to us how the garage and the race trailer are like a hospital's operating room, where sometimes very serious problems have to be fixed in a short amount of time.
It's obvious that Hunter's dad had a lot of influence on him getting him into racing, but I wonder about his mom watching him hurtle around a track, you know, as a dad. I know it'd make me nervous, but how does Hunter's mom handle all this?
You know, it's hard on the moms. A few weeks back, I mentioned the little Burton kid. I asked his mother, he's 12 years old, you know, and he's racing with us in super late models, and I asked her before the race. He happened to qualify next to us, and his mom was there as they were strapping him in the car. And I said, what do you think about your kid, you know, 12 years old racing at this level? I mean, yes. She said if it was up to her, they'd be 20 years old before they could get in the car. So that was how she felt about it.
Well, I appreciate this tour. It's been Sure. It's been great.
Sure,
I've learned a lot.
Sure.
And thanks, Stevie Ray.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate it so much.
Enjoyed having you.
Take
care. Hope you learned something.
All righty.
It's race day, and the excitement is really building. The entire track is a hive of activity. Hunter and his crew are going over his car with a fine-tooth comb and making final adjustments. For us, it's a fine line between trying to learn about what's going on and not getting in the way.
Stevie Ray.
Yes, sir.
What are you about to do? What are y'all doing right now on the car?
I'm checking the front U-joint.
The front U-joint?
Right.
Can we follow you up under there when you go?
Sure.
All right, let's go.
Right arm anymore, I guess not. It's been hanging over that daggum header for the last.
How's that project going there, Jordan?
About done.
Good. Everything going together good? You found bolts good enough for it?
Yeah, and we didn't get too much silicone, we're good.
Correct them out.
Yeah, I listen well.
Well.
You listen well.
Done this a time or two. I just wanted to.
Wow. You know, that's what.
Well, you know what my number is today, don't you?
What?
On my wristband?
No.
18.
Is it really?
Yes.
I didn't even look at my wristband.
Apparently, we drew number 18.
Oh, really?
Yeah. 18's a wild.
Today. Well, we stayed in room 1818, and the very next day, I went to Winn-Dixie and bought some stuff for breakfast, and it was 1818.
No way.
Now, are y'all saying that race car drivers and crews are superstitious?
Could you tell?
Just a tad. Was it that obvious?
You don't have any peanuts in your pocket, do you?
Yeah. Please, no peanuts.
No, well, something must have happened with peanuts.
Something always bad happens with peanuts.
The kind of adjustments y'all are making now, are they like routine before any race, or are these specifically something
this is
based
like
on what y'all saw with the practice
most
yesterday?
Of what Stevie's doing is routine stuff that he does every weekend. It's kind of nut and bolt and make sure that everything's tight. We don't have anything that's loose or got overlooked during the week.
Okay.
Just regular nut and bolt and stuff.
It's kind of like a pre-flight inspection.
Yeah, exactly.
Gotcha.
What this is.
Gotcha.
Once the adjustments are made, it's off to the track for a couple of practice laps. Then it's right back to the pits for further adjustments and back out to the track again. The day is basically an endless cycle of tinker with the car, practice, and repeat. For those who love the internal combustion engine, it's heaven.
I mean, we all have pretty much access to the same equipment. It's all shocks and springs and tires and variables. Variable angles on the car, there's thousands compounded variables. And it's whoever can dial all those variables in is gonna be the front of the field.
But there are also rules, and so everybody has to operate basically within the same set of rules,
right? The parameter is right. We're in somewhat of a box.
So the adjustments you make within that defined set of rules can give you an edge.
That's right, we operate on as far on the edge of the box as we can.
When someone comes up to you that's not a race fan, that you know, doesn't appreciate the sport, how do you express why, you know, you've got these guys going really fast in cars, making one left turn after another? What are you looking at when you look at the sport that really turns you on?
That would attract the average fan. Yeah. Well, the number one thing is for the average fan to pick a person and learn their personality, and then that gives a face to the car. They know that their guy is in that car. You know, in Hunter Robbins, for instance, you know, he goes to college. He's got lots of college friends, so they'll be out in the stands tonight. You know, they know him away from racing, and so then, you know, then they get to watch him go head to head, you know, in the race car. So that's something.
And so what drew you to racing, and first as a fan, and then actually to get involved as a member of a crew?
Well, I think the first part of racing, what a lot of people come for, is the carnage, you know, of the wrecks. You know, mm-hmm. you know, when you're a 12-year-old boy and you think you can go to a place and watch cars wreck, that's a draw, you yeah. know.
But, well, when you were a kid, you know, you were telling me a story about your first encounter with this track. Tell it again about when you were 10 years old.
Well, I was actually about 12 years old, and I wasn't able to afford to get in this place. Just like any kid that's 12 years old, I didn't have any money, but we lived in Montgomery, and we got a ride out here, and we built a little tree house in the pine tree down there. And on Saturday nights, we'd come out here and climb that pine tree and watch, you know, watch races. Back then, they didn't have the wall, so a lot of times the race cars would go off that end, and we'd actually get to see them real close. They were sliding below the pine tree that we were climbed in, you know.
Well, it sounds like we need to go to the driver's meeting.
Yes, sir. That'd be a good thing for you guys to do.
All right, thank you.
Right over there.
Thanks, Steve.
At the driver's meeting, the track officials lay out the sequence of events and the rules for today's race.
I don't care if you're running five-star bodies. If this sticker ain't on your car when you pull into victory lane where everybody can see it, you just made $1,000 less. You don't go to the next person who has the sticker. You have to run this decal at this race.
At technical inspection, all of the cars are weighed and their dimensions are measured. This is very important for both compliance and safety reasons. And once the team is through that phase, Hunter is able to take just a moment to talk with us.
Joey Brackner.
Hunter Robbins.
Yeah, well, I've heard a lot about you, Hunter. You grew up here in Montgomery, right?
Yes, sir.
Now, did you grow up coming to this track and watching races, or?
I did. I mean, I came here a little bit when I was younger. I mean, I didn't really come to a whole bunch of races here when I was younger, just because I was always gone on the weekends racing somewhere, racing go-karts and racing smaller cars and stuff, coming up to the ranks. And I came out here a couple times, and then I was like, wow, this is really, really cool. I was actually, the couple times I did come out here was actually working on pit crews and stuff, and I was like 8 or 9 years old, kind of helping people, they were taking tires on and off or whatever. And then a couple short years after that, I got into one of these late model cars, and I was like 13, 14 years old, and was racing against some of the same guys that I was helping, and that was really cool. But and then actually my very first full season here in a late model, I ended up winning the Alabama 200 at the end of the year, which was the biggest race, and that was really awesome. And then I've been able to win at least a couple races here a year, so it's my home track, but I run really good here, and a lot of laps, and I love performing well in front of all the friends and family that come out to watch.
Well, I can understand how a mechanical engineer would be into racing, because, you know, the car is so important, but not necessarily to be a driver. So, I mean, what do you think makes a good driver?
Well, I mean, people always say, you know, it's just kind of natural talent, but I've kind of come up not having the best equipment, and, just had mediocre equipment, but yet have still been able to find great success. But a lot of people have the very best equipment that money can buy, and well, they run pretty good too. But I mean, you surround yourself with the best people and the best cars, and you should be able to find success. But I think it's kind of measured on how hard you actually work as a driver.
I see you looking nervously out here. Is it almost time for you to practice?
Yeah, we got about almost 2 hours of practice here, but we practiced most time last night, so. Hopefully we'll just kind of see what it's got today, and then just get ready for the race.
Good luck in the race, Hunter.
All right, thank you.
All right.
After the car is finally dialed in, it's time for qualifying. Each car gets 2 laps to determine their position at the start of the race. After qualifying, the crew is forbidden from touching the car. There's nothing for the drivers to do but wait for the race to begin. For the spectators, there is a series of shorter races between mostly local cars of various sizes and classes. And then, it's time for the main event.
Another from Steve, a major
man.
seventh in the point. Right here in Montgomery, Alabama, the number 18, Hunter Robbins. Guard in field. He is leading in the point. He from the Noah, Georgia, the number 26, Bob Hunter.
Two, three.
As I stood atop the race trailer and nervously watched with Hunter's mom, it was easy to see why auto racing is one of the most popular spectator sports in the world. The marriage of human talent, technology, and danger makes for a complex and exciting sport. Now, I'll be able to follow racing with a new eye. The short tracks found in Alabama communities are still a vital part of the racing industry. Fertile grounds for future racing legends.